Peachtree TV presents Monica Pearson One-on-One, sponsored by Montlick Injury Attorneys.
Actors, musicians, even world champs. It's been a year of getting to know things you never knew about your favorite celebrities. Tonight, we're taking a look back at some of our most memorable guests. Let's get things started with the one and only Dolly Parton. I had the chance to go one-on-one with her at her namesake theme park, Dollywood, where she was celebrating the 50th anniversary of the song, I'll Always Love You.
If I should stay, well, I would only be in your way. So I'll go, but I know I'll think of you each step of the way. And I will always love you. I will always love you.
Can you believe it? It's just hard to believe that song is 50 years old, but it has done well. Every 10 years or so, somebody else comes out with it as a hit, or we play it again. I'm the only person that's ever had a number one song twice, you know, with the same song. I did it when I had it out first time whenever that was, 50 years ago. And then when I did Best Little Whorehouse in Texas with Burt Reynolds, it became number one again. Then I had a top 10 song as a duet with Vince Gill. And then, of course, Whitney. And different people keep recording it. So it's just the song that just going to live on forever, like 9 to 5, I guess. Fine by me. I get my royalties. Lord knows I need the money. You know my famous joke. Cause a lot to look this cheap.
Dolly has parked her tour bus. You actually can spend the night in Suite 1986 for a price at the Dollywood Dreammore Resort. But don't think she's retiring.
I will never retire. I will always rewire, like you said, because I reinvent myself, as they say all the time. I'm about to do a rock and roll album. I'm going to be a rock and roll star at 77 years old, which I get a kick out of that. But I'm sincere about the music. I'm sincere about the project, and it's really good. It's some of the best work I've ever done with some of the greatest artists and some of the greatest iconic songs ever.
Like what?
Well, like Paul McCartney sang with me and played piano on Let It Be, and Ringo played the drums. We got John Fogerty singing with me. We got Stevie Nicks, and we got Joan Jett playing the guitar and singing with me. We got all kinds of, we got Elton John, and we've just got all kinds of great artists. I'm doing a lot of their songs, then they singing with me on them. So we're going to do like a big box set. There's 30 songs actually that we've recorded. But anyhow, point is, I seem to know what to do. And when all that little controversy about the Hall of Fame, when I didn't want to be in it, because I didn't think I had earned that. I just felt like when you say the Hall of Fame, you think it's like people that have spent their whole life in rock and roll, you know? And like I've spent mine in country. I'll take anything they give me in country because I feel I've earned it if they'll give it to me because I work at that. But then I thought, well, if I'm going to get it anyway, I need to do a rock album. I don't want nothing that I don't earn. So I'm going to see if I can earn it. So that's kind of why I did the album.
Well, I find it interesting because now your voice sounds more rock than it did when you first did I Will Always Love You.
Yeah. Well, that's because you grow as you come. But I can still go back, though. Some of my favorite music of all is mountain music, old folk, old world music. That's best suited for my voice, you know, for my little natural voice, my mountain voice. But through the years, I've just tried to develop and grow into that, and through the years, I've strengthened my voice because I never quit singing.
I dreamed that I would be a success. I wanted to be a success, and I've always said, as a joke, but it's actually true, that I've dreamed myself into a corner because you can't just see, okay, I'm done now. You know, the dreams came true, so there. You really have to live up to all the things that you've seen, and you have so many opportunities that come from every dream. a new dream comes from that and a new one from that. So it's just really, it just goes on and on. And I just love to work. I always said, like today in our press conference, that I live on spiritual and creative energy. And that just spurs me on. And I love to work. I love what I do.
The other love of her life is her husband, Carl Dean. They got married in Ringgold, Georgia, almost 57 years ago, for a good reason.
Well, because I'm from Georgia, I have to say, y'all got married in Ringgold, Georgia?
We got married in Ringgold because we had planned a wedding. And the reason that we went to Ringgold, because I didn't want it in the Tennessee papers that we got married, because I had just signed a contract and the record label wanted me to wait for a year to get married because they spent all this money. So I went that weekend and got married to Ringgold, Georgia. That's why we went to Ringgold. And then a year later, when everything was going really good, the head of the label said, "See, ain't you glad you didn't get married because things are going so well?" I said, "I got married the same weekend you told me not to."
You've always been sassy.
Well, I wasn't doing it to be sassy. I was in love.
From country to hip hop. Coming up next, I go one-on-one with two College Park natives who've made their mark on hip hop right here in Atlanta. He's known on the street and on the stage as Bone Crusher. He looks like a sumo wrestler, but actually is a Grammy-nominated artist. He hit it big on the rap charts with his number one single, Never Scared. It's time to go one-on-one with Atlanta native Wayne Harnett Jr., better known as Bone Crusher.
All right, now this, you gotta help me, because I'm of another generation.
Oh.
Define crunk for me.
Crunk is energy, pure energy. Fun, elation. It is a birthright of Memphis and Georgia, right? Memphis from 3-6 Mafia, Project Pat, to Ball and G, all the way to Atlanta with myself, Lil Jon, and all the other cast of players that are involved with it, right? You got Ying Yang Twins in there, and that's really the whole overall view of what crunk is. It's energy spread through family. That's what crunk is. Crunk feels like family. That's why it's timeless, why people still like it. Because when we invented it, when I invented my song, it came from love, from respect. Even though it got a lot of anger in it, if you listen to it, it's real singing. Mm-hmm. So that singing is a respect to music and musicology. The reason why John, myself, and Ying Yang and some of the other players involved, Scrappy and all them, are still relevant today is because when we did it for the inspiration of love and music. It may not have been, it's no different than when Cab Calloway came out, they thought he was risque. Think about that. Think about Billie Holiday when she came out, they thought she was really risque, right? Now we see her as one of the greatest of all time, right? But every time span has that. Think about Ray Charles singing those records from the church.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying to you? And people are like, "Man, you blasphemous." They throwing stuff at him. But now Ray Charles is looked at as a martyr of the business. From the way he handled business, the way he approached his music. And that is really what crunk is. Crunk is that same thing. Because we respect music so much, the avenue in which it came through us, that's how we brought it back. We brought it back to the world in that same way.
There's this guttural sound in the lyrics.
Pain and passion. That's what it is.
With a deep Southern bass.
It is, all Southern. It's all Atlanta. It's real Atlanta.
And he is Atlanta. Grew up in Adamsville, started at Harper High School, then graduated from Banneker High in 1989. He went to college even though he didn't want to go.
Now, how did your parents feel about you wanting to go into entertainment?
It was split. My grandfather didn't care what I did as long as I was committed, right? And all the education, once he told me what all the education was being forced on me about, was that I was to figure out what I wanted to do and what I didn't want to do. When I figured out that music would be my everything, I took my hammer. I was working on North Spring High School, right here off of Roswell Road here. And I threw my hammer all the way off the building. I said, "Man, I ain't doing this no more." At the time, this is like 1990, 91, 92, I was making $1,000 a week almost, like $800 to $1,000 a week. And back then, that was a lot of money. For me to come home, stay with my grandparents, telling them that I'm quitting this job to do music, understand that there's no music business back then, so there's no blueprint for them to say, well, maybe. It's like, oh, no, you lost your mind, boy. That music ain't gonna do that. And then you're not even singing. You're doing this hip-hop, bebop, bloop-bop, bop, boy, you lost your mind. And when my grandfather really knew that I wanted to do it and he really appreciated me doing what I was doing and loved it, was when I had just came home from the studio early that morning, like 4 or 5 o'clock. And then I went and I got right back up at like 8. So that's like 3 hours of sleep, right? I take a shower, get ready. So I'm trying to get out the house for my grandpa to get home. What time did you get in last night? I said about, 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock? You got in at 4 o'clock. You got up. I mean, you got up at 7 at least, take a shower. It's 8 o'clock. Your grandma wake you up? I said, nah, her grandma woke me up, not for no hip hop, bebop in my head. I'm like, no, no way. My grandma ain't even talking to me. She mad at me, right? So he's like, oh, wait a minute now. Your grandma didn't wake you up. Did the alarm go off? I said, nah, I just woke up. The sun woke me up. The sun woke you up. I said, yeah. He said, I tell you what, I think you figured it out. I said, what? He said, I think you figured it out. I think that's what you need to be doing. I said, oh, uh-oh. I said, for real? He said, man, if you are willing to go through the things that we put you through to get you here, and you still at it, man, it brings tears to my eyes.
Oh.
Real talk.
So did he see your first
Never.
Hit? No.
Never saw it. Never saw it.
My next guest is known for producing Atlanta booty shake music and Southern hip hop with the Ying Yang Twins, Bubba Sparks, Soulja Boy, and many more. I learned why Mr. Collipark is headed in a new direction when I went one-on-one with him.
Where did this music thing come from?
Well, my dad was in the band. My oldest brother was in the band. Two of my older brothers were in the band. And so I looked up to my oldest brother, Kevin. I wanted to do everything he wanted to do. He knew how to do the Michael Jackson. I wanted to do the Michael Jackson. And so he played the trumpet. I wanted to play the trumpet. So I was actually in the marching band. And he would buy records. And so he had a little turntable set up in his room. So when he started buying all those 12 inches and stuff, I would sneak in when he wasn't at home and start messing with him. And that's how I started getting into like one of the DJ. It was by messing his records up on his turntable. I didn't have no slip pads or nothing. I would scratch the bottom of them up because I would scratch on them, but there was no slip pad up under the bottom. So it would mess his records up. So yeah, that's how
that was the beginning.
Yeah, that was the beginning.
Did you expect what you do to turn into a career of long standing?
You gotta understand, back then the only label was Itchy Bun. Itchy Bun Records up in Kennesaw. There was no So-So Def, there was no LaFace. It was John and Nina Abbey up in Kennesaw. And so we didn't think that it was a reality for us to become lifetime musicians that could actually pay bills through music. So when I was doing it, I was just having fun for the love of music. Who knew what was coming?
So tell me about your friends, particularly Mr. Bone Crusher, who I interviewed. So how did you two
yes.
meet?
We went to high school together. And Bone wanted to be a DJ at first. And so he would come over to my house to learn how to DJ, because I was like the neighborhood DJ. And I didn't even know Bone was rapping. I never knew he, you know, back then, and he has a great story of how it all happened. I didn't remember none of this stuff because a lot of stuff has happened. But he would come over and try to learn how to DJ. Next thing I know, he's Bone Crusher with a hit record. So who knew? All of this is like right in the neighborhood. Yeah, and I went to school with Mr. DJ, with Outkast. He would come over my house to learn how to DJ.
And what about Luda?
Luda was younger than us. Luda was interning for Itchy Bun. That's how I met him first.
There's like this little germination in College Park.
Right. Let me just say this about Itchy Bun, because whenever the story of Atlanta gets told, nobody mentions Itchy Bun Records. They were here first. Everybody was signed to Itchy Bun. Kilo was signed to Itchy Bun. We were. MC Breed was on Itchy Bun when he did the Gotta Get Mine. He was living here. everybody was on Itchy Bun Records, but people seem to forget that time frame, because back then it was truly independent. There was no major budgets or money, nothing like that. So I just wanted to get that out.
What is it about your music you think makes people go, I want to hear more of that? Because I just saw what you did down in New Orleans for Mardi Gras.
Right, right.
And you even mentioned that you were surprised at how the crowd, which was a very mixed crowd, more white than black.
Right, it was 95% white. I think because where I come from with the music marching band, I went to a HBCU. It's so culturally driven. It's not radio driven. It's like for my people. Like even Ying Yang Twins, the strip club is a part of Atlanta culture. So when we did Whistle While You Twerk, that was for the culture inside of 285. We didn't know it was gonna blow up and go all over everywhere. When we did Halftime Stand Up and Get Crunk, which became the theme song for New Orleans Saints, that was a HBCU song.
And Mr. Collipark signed the Ying Yang Twins. When we return, I sit down with the hip hop duo who share with me how they overcame physical disabilities and bullies to become a hip hop sensation. They are the Ying Yang Twins, but they're not twins and they're not blood brothers either. They're not even cousins. But when it comes to music, they are always on the same page as the kings of what is called booty shake or stripper music.
So you all have made an unbelievable career out of great booty shake music.
Right.
But how did you two get together? Because Mr. Collipark told me one story.
That's the million-dollar story.
All right.
You know, Atlanta was only, the club scene, Atlanta was always known for the exotic club.
The strippers.
Yeah, right. That's where you break your music, in the booty shake game.
Well, we started it in Atlanta. Let me start it off right,
there you
though.
Go.
Let me
go.
Start it off real right.
Go.
All right, it started off from, I love Criss Cross. I love Criss Cross to death.
Right.
And my mama got me a ticket to a Criss Cross concert. And when she picked me up, I said, Mama, I can do that. And she was like, well, if you could take yourself in the studio, you can rap. Like, I was like 12 years old.
Right.
So I cut grass with my granddaddy all summer until the last week of school. And I took myself in the studio and made a demo tape. And I made that demo tape and I sent it out to just whoever I seen in the phone book. You know, we didn't have internet. Let's get anxious, you know.
Hand to book.
Yeah.
It was
really in the mail, you know, you got it in the mail, you know. So, you know, somebody hit me back and I ended up making Bankhead Bounce when I was 15. And Michael Jackson did the Bankhead Bounce and everything. That blew my mind right there. And then, you know, a couple of situations that I was on Itchy Bun and I ended up doing a song with Mr. Collipark, but he wanted me and Kane to do it.
I met the A-Town Hard Boys before their album dropped, which was like 88, 89. My nickname was Handy. I used to sweep in the barbershop. And the barbershop at the time used to house all the superstars in America. Like Bell Bill DeVoe, ABC, New Edition. I met all these folks before I was 12. So the A-Town Hard Boys, they walked in the barbershop. I was sweeping, and I was notorious for freestyle rapping. And so my barber says, hey, man, put something in your rap about the Hard Boys just walked in the barbershop. So I bust the freestyle, wop, sweeping. And D says to Royal C, hey, Charles, he rapped so good, he need to be an honorary Hard Boy. He said, no. He needed to be a Hard Boy. And then Raw C and D started telling D-Rock and I about each other. Like for about 3 or 4 years, they told me and D-Rock about each other. And I didn't meet him till he came out with Bounce, Shorty Bounce.
D-Rock was born with a deformed left hand and Kane was born with a mild case of cerebral palsy.
When I was born, my mom said my legs were turned out like the Flintstones, so I used to lean forward. She said, when you first came out, I was like, oh, heck no.
She said, I had to call them doctors in there. Look here, y'all gonna have to break my baby leg, turn these legs straight. We ain't finna do this. And so they said, I wasn't never supposed to walk. 13 tubes in my head, lungs weren't developed. D-Rock, premature hand. My mom says, you replace D-Rock hand and he replaced your leg.
So were y'all teased about your disabilities as kids?
Yes, ma'am. Listen,
man, I'm gonna tell you, we from Atlanta. Ma'am.
I took up for D-Rock one time, and he might not
want me. We from Atlanta.
Yeah. I took up for D-Rock one time and didn't even know him. We were in the sixth grade. It was some brothers in my apartments. I always used to pick on everybody, even me. I used to have to fight all three of them walking to the store in the apartments we stayed in. They were just like that. The boy picked on D-Rock. We was in the sixth grade. D-Rock ran out to school. I pushed him and said, hey, man, why you messing with the man? The man don't even want no problem, man. Do me. He said, hey, Crip, man, I'm just messing with the man. I say, mess with me. He ain't even messing with you, bro. Let me and you do it.
Now, D-Rock, how'd you deal with people picking on you?
I'm going to tell you the same way I told them. We po'.
That's a good one.
And we didn't have no money, and I got hungry, and I ate my fingers.
No, you didn't.
Let it be. I'm just saying, when we were growing up, if you joned yourself, a person wouldn't mess with you. It's like, what can you say about me if I joned myself? People don't actually know the struggle that we went through growing up. You know, we went through a struggle. We had our own battles, you know. It wasn't just like we were just like, bam, the Ying Yang Twins.
Right.
It was like, no, we both from the project.
Right.
We both came from nothing and had to make ourselves something.
Right. And I think the Ying Yang Twins, we're like, to me, we're the greatest of being the people's champs. We're the poster children of proof that anyone can make it.
Coming up next, I go one-on-one with Janelle Monáe, who talks about her role on the big screen in the Netflix hit Glass Onion, a Knives Out mystery. Glass Onion, a Knives Out mystery, made its big screen debut earlier this year. That's when actress Janelle Monáe and movie director Rian Johnson stopped by Peachtree TV to talk about the film.
The movie is a whodunit, a murder mystery set on a Greek island owned by a tech billionaire, Miles Braun, played by Edward Norton. He literally lives in a house with a glass onion-shaped dome roof. The twists and turns and clues keep you guessing throughout the film, just as director Rian Johnson planned.
What caused you to write the storyline?
Well, this all starts with my love of Agatha Christie. I grew up loving mysteries, and I grew up loving whodunit mysteries, and also the kind of big, fun, all-star cast mysteries I used to watch when I was a kid. And this, both of these movies, Knives Out and now Glass Onion, this one that Janelle's in, it's an attempt to kind of get back to that, you know?
But you know, when I saw the title, Glass Onion, two things immediately came to mind. My mother always said people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones.
That's good advice.
And then the second was, you know, which I think is pretty funny, with onions, they peel apart layer by layer, but if you cut it the wrong way, the next thing you know, you're cracked.
Well, this should be in the movie. This should be in the, I should have given this to Benoit Blanc to say.
Exactly.
I know. I'm calling you when I'm writing next time.
But no, the thought was, why the name? But really, how did you come up with the name Glass Onion, and why? Because yes, the house has this onion, but there's gotta be more to it than that.
There's a little bit more to it. It's also the name of one of my favorite Beatles songs. So for me, I love naming these movies after songs that I love, so far at least. So you're right, it's a metaphor because it's densely layered, but it's made of glass. You can also see right through it, which has something to do with the mystery in the movie. But it's also a fantastic Beatles song.
Well, why did you pick Janelle Monáe to play this character? And because I don't want to give anything away, so I have to be careful. Play a character who really is two people.
She's got multiple sides to her in the movie. She absolutely does. I mean, there are a million reasons that why wouldn't I feel so incredibly lucky.
Can you spot the other thing?
the real thing this group has in common.
Andy, come on.
Oh, Lionel. Everybody knows who Lionel works for. That's no secret. And we know who bankrolled Claire's campaign.
So Janelle is a storyteller. And through her having been a fan of her music and a fan of her work on the screen, but hugely through her just seeing with her albums how she's telling stories, she's creating characters. She has a storyteller's mind, a storyteller's spirit, and that's what I was looking with this part. It's a very complicated part in the murder mystery. I needed a storyteller to be a collaborator with me.
It was just an honor and a dream to be a part of this ensemble, be a part of this film that takes us on these wild, crazy rides. I mean, when I read it, I was like, okay, this is going to be one of the like biggest challenges in terms of like roles I've done in the best possible way. Because of the layered character, like the peeling back of the layers that you have to do on Andy. You know, she's super mysterious. She's also this leader. She's this gatherer, complicated past with the rest of the characters, these things. So I would say, you know what, actually, to tell you the truth, like I think in terms of like leadership, perhaps we have some things in common. I mean, you know, being in the entertainment industry, you know, having to like strongly believe in your ideas and champion, be your own champion at a lot of times when people don't believe in what it is you're doing, or sometimes people can be dismissive because of what you look like or who you are, or you know, all of those things. I think Andy and I, we intersect on, because she is in an industry where she is the minority and the majority. She does have to get people to believe in her ideas, and she has to protect her ideas as well. So there's some things there, but I think for the most part, I got an opportunity to just explore and learn different things about me as an actor, and do the comedic stuff, the deep emotional dramatic scenes, action. I got a chance to really play with this role and like go to new places, you know, as an actor.
While watching the movie, one thing hit me very clearly is that I can see you in the movie in the sense that I can see your thought pattern, but I also can see how you two, in some ways, you directed her, but in some ways she directed you.
Absolutely.
100%. No, 100%. Listen, this is the captain of the ship here. No,
but what'd you learn from him? Because you want to be a director.
Ooh, I do. Look at you doing your work. What? I absolutely do desire to direct. And I think what I learned most about him is just, you know, you can be talented, you can be creative, and you can redefine what power looks like. Like it doesn't always look, you know, chaotic, or in order to get the best out of your artists, you don't have to lead with a stressful set. We must do. Like you can be prepared like Ryan, be calm. I mean, I never saw this guy lose his cool. And things happen, like it's a production. You know, things happen. We're in the middle of COVID trying to film this, and he always set the tone for us to come in and like, you know, play, have a good time, like family vibes. And that's what I love. I want to make, when I do start directing, make all of my actors feel how Rian Johnson made me feel working on this film.
So what's the message in the movie?
Well, the message is kind of, you know, we worked really hard to kind of, you know, bake something about society into this really light, delightful, entertaining souffle. So I'm hesitant to just come out and say,
talk.
But at the same time, I will say this, it's, you know, one really fun thing about this genre, about whodunit mysteries, you're creating a cast of characters, of suspects, and there's a power structure within that group of suspects. And the person at the top, everyone wants to bump off. And it's, you can see by creating it, you're kind of creating a little microcosm of society. And so I think these movies are specifically good in an entertaining framework of engaging with society and reflecting it back on ourselves. And
so is it Elon Musk?
It's not. You're going to try to get me in trouble, trying to get me busted. I think it's more about all of them, I think. It's not that fun just making fun of one person. To me, looking at the whole group, their place in society, our relationship to those folks, and kind of what we want them to be, that to me feels a lot more interesting.
He starred in the hit show NCIS New Orleans. When we return, Daryl Mitchell opens up about the near-death experience that left him paralyzed. You may know my next guest as a rapper, TV and movie actor, or even a comedian. No matter what role he's playing, I learned he's not letting anything stop him, not even his disability, when I went one-on-one with Daryl Mitchell.
Well, NCIS New Orleans is when I first was introduced to you as Patton.
Oh, on the show. Oh.
On the show.
What about that panelist that proposed an amplified DOS storm attack on the stock market service?
It's terrifying. At least the half that I understood. No, I'm just glad that these scenarios are hypothetical.
Wait, hold up. What happened to my conspiracy-minded buddy? Our government is sitting on those same weapons right now, just itching to use.
Yeah, well, if they are, then I don't want to know about it. You know, it's the stuff of nightmares.
Well, you know what? Let's see which panelist is going to keep you up all night next.
Well, first time I saw you, it was like, okay, is he going to be a continuing character? And you just said they hadn't planned to make you a continuing character.
Well, we gotta go backwards, because okay. we gotta talk about the whole accident. Woo, that was something else that was different.
It was in November 2001, Daryl went to Beaufort, South Carolina, jumped on his nephew's new Kawasaki motorcycle. Daryl was an experienced rider, but he didn't wear a helmet that night. Helmets aren't required by law in South Carolina for people over the age of 21.
You gotta know the roads that you're riding on sometime, and that was the thing. When I went up the road, I wasn't speeding. I just went up the road this way, and when I came back this way, it was the salt water wash over the road, because this place called Wausau Island, it was washed out. It was loose. So, you know, you lean into the turn, that back tire said, pshoo, that bike said, right on top of you, boop. And that's what damaged my spinal cord.
So rehabilitation was like?
It was scary. It was good, because that staff is they real good, and they're funny. They were fun, and they realized that, you know, I mean, the thing when the doctor told me, like, you know, it's possibility you never walk again. I'm like, what's next? What's next, doctor? You know what? I'm gonna come back, cause you might not understand. I said, no, you come back, you're gonna get the same answer. What's next?
Why did you not have depression or feel sorry for yourself?
Well, I mean, you know what? You can't allow yourself to go there. You know, that's the thing. It's like, I'll cry later, but I got a battle now. And my main thing was I got to get out of this bed, because I got to feed my kids. And I was just like, nah, I got to get back to work. You know, and I mean, I'm not saying initially, you got to make the decision. What you going to do? You going to roll or fold? That's the name of my book. You got to decide what you're going to do right at that instant. And I was like, and you know what? I'm going to war. It's just a whole different fight, but I'm going to fight it till I can't fight no more.
So how difficult was it after your accident and your rehab to get work?
That was interesting. You know what? I always tell people, always respect everybody, because you're going to meet the same people going up. You're going to meet them on the way coming down. And I paid my dividends. And the thing about it is, when I came out the hospital, Denzel was up for an Oscar for Training Day. And I told him, I said, you're going to win. He said, you think you're going to win? I said, yeah. He said, you think I'm going to win? Come on out here. I was like, I'm on my way. Never traveled by myself in a wheelchair. And I knew. I told my family, I said, I got to make this trip by myself. Because once I make this trip on my own, then I know I can manage it. And I did it. I went to LA, I rented a car, hand controlled everything. Went down to Sunset, to the Hyatt, stayed there, and, you know, call everybody, let them know I'm in LA. You know, come and see me. Everybody, Regina King, everybody came to visit me right at the hotel. Denzel came, picked me up, took me to go see another friend of ours. But that right there was a good test for me, that moved me forward. And then after I got to LA, I met with one of the directors that used to direct Larry Katz's show. He was like, man, he said, ain't nothing different. You just sitting down. I was like, dude, I'm ready to go. He said, I would make a phone call because I got a friend who's looking to put a character on the show. It's a TV show called Ed in New York. I said, no problem. So he set it up. I went and met with them. These dudes was nervous because they was like, they had no idea or no intentions of meeting with somebody in a wheelchair. So they sat down with me and I just started telling them about some of the funny things that I go through or happens to me just in the situation. And before I would say anything, I left there. We never see the script. Got home, they called me. They was like, man, you got the job, bro.
And more roles followed. Brothers with Michael Strahan that drew guest appearances from Kim Kardashian and Mike Tyson. The role of Patton Plame on NCIS New Orleans originally was only for 2 episodes, but morphed into 7 years on the show. Coming up next, I go one-on-one with 2 heavyweight champs. George Foreman and Evander Holyfield talk everything from championships to faith and family. Now we head to the boxing ring with 2 champs, the greatest of all time, Evander Holyfield, and the comeback kid, George Foreman, who has a story made for the movies.
George Foreman still looks like the boxer he once was. He's a businessman and full-time preacher now. He's been retired from boxing for 26 years. He wrote his autobiography 28 years ago and finally agreed to a movie about his life. It came out this year.
Never seen anything like this.
What made you say, this is the time to tell my story?
Well, I've been telling the story for so long, especially about my evangelistic work and how I found God and found Jesus, but I thought it was all told, but when the idea of a movie sticking around after I'm passed, that made me think, oh, that's the right time.
Now, there'd been a movie on Ali, there'd been a movie on Chuck Wepner, who was the original Rocky, yeah. And of course, Mike Tyson. Had you seen those?
Yeah, I looked at a lot of those movies and I enjoyed them.
But what did you not see in them that you felt you needed to have in yours?
There had to be a true story. I mean, not about me being victorious and winning everything, but about what went on beyond boxing. And that's a life story about triumphs from a baby all the way into champion of the world at 45. That I needed to tell.
There was a scene in the movie where you had just mugged someone and you jumped into this area where there obviously was sewage. It was kind of like a vision of you having been in sewage all your life. Did that really happen?
Yeah, you know what happened? The police were chasing me and I thought they were gonna have the dogs to sniff me out. And I'd heard when the police are chasing criminals, they go into waters and they can't smell through water. So I got sewage and thought, now they won't be able to smell me. And I'll never forget that hot digging from head to toe under sewage so the dogs wouldn't smell me.
But you know, that's kind of like how your life went from sewage to clean. And that really came about when you had that moment in Puerto Rico where it was a near-death experience. Tell me about that.
Well, I was literally fighting for my life in the dressing room. No one knew what was going on. Gotten too hot. I'd lost a decision, but I wasn't hurt. There was fighting for my life, and eventually I lost my life in that dressing room. In a vision, in a split second, I was dead and alive again. Over my head, under my feet was nothing, to be lost forever. And I remember thinking, I don't care if this is death, I still believe there's a God. I just didn't believe in religion. When I said that, I was rescued out of nothingness, alive in that dressing room. Evidently, they picked me up off the floor, and my doctor standing behind me, I said, move your hand because the thorns on his head are making him bleed. And my masseur, I said, move your hand, he's bleeding where they crucified him. I didn't believe in religion. I started screaming, Jesus Christ was coming alive in me. My life has not been the same since.
And that's when you also left boxing, but started your church.
How has that church grown?
10 years I was out of boxing. Preaching on the street corner, some kids came up to me because the first church we were in, there were so many preachers, you couldn't get a chance to talk. I tell my testimony, of course. They said, George, we know where you can preach. And they took me on the street corner. And that's where my ministry started, on the street corner. And eventually we got our own church started, the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ in Houston. And you know what? It's been the same because I've been there for 44 years.
Who do you think was the greatest boxer?
Well, boxing is strange. There's so many great boxers. There's enough room for 20 people to say I'm the greatest. But one of the most great men I've ever met was Muhammad Ali. A great man. It's been hard to top that.
The 1991 fight between the 28-year-old Evander Holyfield and the 42-year-old George Foreman was called the Battle of the Ages. Foreman was trying to make a comeback, but fell short in the 12-round match that Holyfield won by a unanimous decision, keeping his belt as the undisputed heavyweight champion.
Evander Holyfield, they call him the real deal. And there's no better explanation or description for Evander Holyfield, the real deal. I fought him so fast and strong. Just when I thought I had him, he was out of the way. And we went 12 rounds, and I lost the decision, but I knew for a fact that this is one of the greater fighters of all time, the real deal, Evander Holyfield.
What's your reaction? What is your reaction to hearing him say that about you?
Well, you know, that's a great compliment, you know, but, you know, George and I, we were both Christian. And so me and George were getting ready to fight. They wanted us, me and him, to get in an argument. Y'all just keep saying these nice things. I had respect for George. He was a bigger person. I knew I was going to hit him 3-1. And like, this is the whole big thing is, now I can't get hit with none of his. In one shot, you can be done. And so they asked me, who do you think is really the very best? I said, has George ever been the heavyweight champion of the world? Because they were saying, who God gonna go for? You or Joyce? This is what they trying to do. Y'all both Christian. Now, who God gonna go for? I said, well, has George ever been the heavyweight champion of the world? They said, well, yeah. I said, okay, then it's my turn. That's it. I beat him. Then eventually I lost against Michael Moore, and he knocked Michael Moore out and became the champion again. So it was his turn. Everybody get a turn. Because I knew he'd been a champion, then he had his turn. I wanted to be the very best that I could be. And I said, I didn't know it was going to be 4 times. I said, but that's what it took. I'm the only fighter that ever been heavyweight champion world 4 times. When I look at it, it's a proven point that even though I to be the very best, I didn't know that you have to lose to be the very best, because it shows you that people who know how to make adjustments are the people who become the very best. And that's a proven point by what happened when things don't go your way. Because everything ain't gonna ever go your way all the time.
You said something very interesting. 4 times heavyweight champion. You were the first to be champion of the cruiser and the heavyweight. So why is it when people think of boxing, they always think of my hometown boy, Muhammad Ali, versus Evander? Because Evander, you've topped them all.
I have people come up and say, who the best between you and Ali? I said, it's just real simple. I said, opinion-wise, Ali. I said, but record-wise, me. I said, so, no, whatever you want to do with it. He was a different fighter. He bragged about it and said he was the greatest and all this. And I said, he was the greatest of his time. I said, you know, and I was the greatest of my time.
But you were the greatest so far all time.
Right, right. You're absolutely right. But why would Ali stand out more? Because he promoted himself. Then nobody else promote themselves like him. I'm the greatest. You got to have some confidence to sit there and say that. Because at any given time, you can lose.
Evander Holyfield was 21 and Mike Tyson was 17 when they first met.
So the thing is that what people don't realize that Mike and I, we was on the losing squad in 1984 trying to make the Olympic team. Now, that's how tough the amateur boxer was back in those days. Me and Mike, we was on the losing squad. I like this, I was a light heavy, Mike was a heavyweight, and we was on the losing squad, so we trying to make the Olympic team. Now, I was able to make it, Mike didn't make it.
Fast forward to 1996, when Tyson was defending his year-old WBA championship and lost it to Evander. But it was the rematch in 1997 billed as the Sound and Fury fight that became known as the Bite Fight.
I'm the only person he didn't knock out. I said, he knocked out all them people. Everybody was scared to fight him. He knocked everybody out. I said, I wasn't afraid. I was called, my mama said, never be afraid of nobody. I'm aggressive, just like Mike. I don't give Mike no room to hit me. I just go straight at him. It worked.
He got so frustrated in that fight in Las Vegas that he did bite your ear, and then you all make a joke out of it.
They appeared together in commercials, one for Foot Locker and another for Tyson Mike Ear Bites, marijuana gummy candies. Holyfield has a sense of humor and believes in forgiveness.
It's the past. I always liked Mike because the fact of the matter is that everybody got something in their life that a little different.
I've really enjoyed getting to know each one of my guests, and I hope you learned a little something new about them as well. Join me every Sunday at 6, right here on Peachtree TV, where you'll get to know the person behind the celebrity. Good night.